Thank you for inviting me to the NEC, certainly the faculty and the board bringing me here. I did graduate here in the 80s, so that I presume no one was born, at least for another 12 years. So, but Brown Hall looks the same, Beethoven looks the same, the dorm looks the same. It's a little eerie, but it's okay, it's all right. It is really cool to be back here. I don't know how many, if we're looking at freshmen, sophomores, juniors, a mixed bag, right? I just wanted to say that some of my funnest and most informative years were here. And that education actually literally helped me get a job doing what I do. And I was here as a classical pianist major. I did do some composition courses, but for the most part it was playing. And then I got into composition after I left, but I did take composition courses here. I'm just curious, are there composition people here, musicians? How many are composition? Great. Well, fantastic. And we have musicians as well. We have some music majors. Great. Great. You know, I was asked when I was here to what would we possibly have a discussion about. And the thing that I wanted to have seen 30 years ago was the process, because everyone here has a composer. I know that by virtue of everyone being in here who's a student, you obviously had something rather special to get to arrive here. So you each have your own unique voice, and I think every colleague I've ever worked with, whether it's Jeff Beal or Mark Snow or Alan Silvestri, they each have their own unique voice. And I work predominantly in the world of television, and then now with the world of streaming media, which I'm sure, I don't know if you have time to watch TV, but in the streaming world, now there's a whole new wave of entertainment on Netflix and so forth and Amazon. And then films, and then I've also done some video game work, and we could certainly have a discussion about the challenges that come with doing game work versus, which is more adaptive writing versus composition for more locked picture. But I thought what would be helpful is to just literally go through the process of what you would go through if you were asked to score a project, if you were asked to work on a TV show, a film, something for Netflix, YouTube, anything. There are certain things that we have in common that you would work together with. So I'm just gonna, full disclosure, I don't normally use this keynote thing, but I'm gonna try because I thought it would be easier than me hovering over a board here. All right. So, as many of you probably know about film and TV and so forth, it's a collaborative medium. When I work on a show, like for example, I just finished this season of Homeland. I don't know if anybody's seen Homeland or the show Jessica Jones or 24 when you were kids. That is harsh to say. But everyone who's working on a show is they're all working in a synchronized way towards telling a story. And the production part, that is the part where the cameras are rolling, that part is the primary production process involving writers, directors, and casting directors, and actors, and set designers, costumes, art director, cinematographer. They all have a skill set. There's all a craft there. And that craft gets all brought into the filming of the picture and so forth. And on a typical TV show, there's about a 7-8 day window where they'll film a show. They'll film an episode of TV. And then the next part is the post-production process, and that's where the music part is where we belong, where we stay. Picture editors is, for many of you who probably edited your own videos, they're sort of the master, they're the masters of putting the show together. They're very trusted. Sometimes they're responsible for the flow and the tone. These are the guys that, when they're putting the show together, sometimes put in temp music, and we can certainly talk about temp music all you want. Temp music is placeholder music, where they're trying to get something going. Hey, this piece of music works great. And then you go look at the show with them, and then they say, we want this piece, and it's something that only, you know, it's something so exotic that, you know, they get so attached to it that it becomes a problem for you. But the picture editors, sound designers, mixers, I actually did sound effects work years ago on the TV show Star Trek, Deep Space Nine. I had to design sound effects when I needed a job. And And I learned a lot about scoring as a result of cutting phaser shots, believe it or not. It was, when you're, anyway, and then visual effects, and then music. And music is part of that process. It's, as you probably realized, it's the one part of, it's something that when you play to someone, anybody can have an immediate opinion about it. You don't have to be a skilled person to say, oh, I love that, or I don't like that. You know, it's a very emotional, subjective thing. And so music is a very, very collaborative process, and it is at the end of the process. It's more towards the end. And when some of the show is not lining up properly, or some of the acting isn't great, or some of the effects look terrible, they often turn to music to try to help save the day. And sometimes we do, and sometimes we don't, but we do. But so in the music department, in a typical music show, there's many different permutations of this, but composer, obviously, we create the music for the show. A music editor is kind of your closest friend. He's the, when I work on Bones or Homeland, there is someone that is on the mix stage. There's someone that's actually taking your music, and they're making sure it plays properly. You can't be every place at once. And they are responsible for making sure that if the picture changes and stuff, you've got to conform it and so forth, and make sure the music plays properly. And then music supervisors are people who choose source music. You know, if you ever heard songs at the opening, if anybody watched Breaking Bad, Breaking Bad had a tremendous source music selection that really got you into the tone of the episode. That lies a little bit adjacent to composing because it's music that's already pre-existing, but it gets dropped into a show and then it becomes inextricably linked to that show, sometimes to good or bad. But those are the three primary parts of it. So I just thought it would be helpful for you to see parts of a script, because whenever you get hired, the very first exposure you have to storytelling is the script. And the scripts, they look like this. This is from a scene from 24. And we have I just wanted to point out, sometimes you hear, there's words like Prime Minister Davies on the tarmac watching solemnly, Air Force One takes over the skies, an abandoned industrial area outside London spotted by morning mist. There's all these little things that writers put into things that when you're reading it, you kind of get a sense of setting and this and that. And when I'm reading a script, I always make note of these little things. A lot of times the writers are putting little bits of behavior for the actor, and the actor takes it and runs with it. Like when Kiefer Sutherland became Jack Bauer, they didn't say, frown, or, you know, be mad. You know, he just sort of made it his own incredible, you know, performance. I brought this up from Homeland because this is the opening of an episode which I have a clip from. And it describes in very great detail a guy wearing black rimmed glasses and a baseball cap rolling behind luggage past him, oblivious to commuters and tourists walking into a place. This is a guy who's going to try to wreak havoc on a train station in Berlin. This was season 5 of 24, of Homeland. And it's just when you read it, revealing what looks like an aqualung, a pair of pressurized canisters bolted attached, it's just, your mind's eye starts just thinking about these things. You know, I start thinking about these things in terms of what color, what tone. It's a busy train station. The baseball cap guys, you know, when you see it, it's just neat to have your imagination start to get going. So we're going to just talk briefly about spotting, and then we'll start playing some things. Spotting is one of the most important things you would actually do. It's kind of an art form. It's deciding where in the show music plays. On the show 24, the music was almost nonstop. You know, it just plays constantly. It was like a propelling character. But on shows like Breaking Bad or on Homeland or on Jessica Jones, it's spread out. It's spread out a little bit more elegantly. And sometimes when music comes in and plays, it profoundly changes your experience. It changes whether you play something, whether you hit something, how you hit it, how you begin playing something. This is often very hotly debated as to how music should play in a scene. And I was going to play this opening scene from Jessica Jones. Now, this is a rough cut. This is a rough cut of the very first episode. So, oh, sorry, Netflix. So this is the main title that I was working on the main title, but they didn't have the graphics. So while this is playing, I'm just going to talk over it. You see a window down there, a counter. A lot of you know what this is, maybe some of you don't. It's SMPTE time codes. It was developed by the Society of Motion Picture and Television Engineers. And what you're seeing is a measurement of every single frame of picture. So when you are looking and talking about where to put music, you will always be referencing these kinds of numbers. And it's measured in hours, minutes, seconds, and frames. And each second of pictures is 30 frames. We're in a digital world now. It used to be different with videotape. It used to be 29.97, 30 frames. But now everyone's in a digital world, which is headache-free. So when we get through the one-minute mark, we then get to... Now you're going to hear some temp score. Actually, I'm going to turn it down just a moment. So then we show black, and now we fade in onto the show. And this is an opening scene where Jessica Jones is talking about what she does for a living. Now I'll bring it up a little bit. Now what you're hearing...
A big part of the job is looking for the worst in people.
You're hearing a temp score? This is not what made it into the score. This was just a point of conversation.
Turns out I excel at that. Clients hire me to find dirt. And I find it. Which shouldn't surprise them, but it does.
That bitch just sleeping with my brother?
Knowing it's real means they gotta make a decision. One, do something about it. Or two, keep denying it. Shoot the messenger. Tell me I'm getting off on ruining their already shitty lives. Option two rarely pans out.
And then there's the matter of your bill.
And this is another scene.
People do bad shit. I just avoid getting involved with them in the first place. That works for me. Most of the time.
So this is basically how a show, and you know, you're looking at the show and notice that every single time, no matter what's playing, that counter is running. And that temp music was stuff that I did as a point of conversation for them, and they actually tossed a lot of it out and they wanted it to be even refined even further. But it was good to have a little point of conversation for it, which is the beginning of the process. So this is a set of spotting notes of that very episode. You notice it started with the Netflix logo, right? Then the main title, minute and 10. And then that very first scene crashes through the door. And then the words getting close. That was meaning that the music that was in there was sort of kind of getting there. But this is where producers would say, hey, you know what? We like this music, but we need more energy. We don't like the performance. This is where you actually would consult these notes. You know, this is where you would, this is sort of your roadmap. So that's a, those are the, that, and then when her face, then there's another piece of music when her face is on the bus. So every time you work on an episode, you'll be working from a set of spotting notes. So anyway, this is the, so that very first cue, we're just as a job, a spotting notes line up there. So yeah, that's what you consult. So as you can see, I'll just run through this very quickly. This is just, Jessica Jones has no commercial breaks. So it's like a movie. It runs an hour straight without any act breaks. So when you look at the cues now, these are the cues that are spread across the show. Those first two pieces of music will play over the course of that hour. What's interesting about spotting, though, is you'll notice that on broadcast television, they're broken up into act breaks. So what happens is when you're creating music for television, you have to take into account that you have big and commercials, you know, stuff like that, or act outs and stuff. And those kind of look like that. So when you're working on long form content without commercials, the pacing and so forth of things can be very, very different. Anyway. More spotting notes. This is film. Anyway, so this was the bomb. This was the spotting notes from that episode, that script, where they come into the train station. Here's that cue, and here's that opening scene. Glasses, baseball hat. Anyway, so it goes down, but I just wanted you to kind of see where it starts in a script, and then all those traits come together to make that unfold, and now it comes to us to have to score it. And obviously it's a bit of a sinister kind of scene, it's turbulent, it's a little unsettling. At the end of the spotting notes, if you look at that number, there were 21 starts. That means there were 21 pieces of music that you have to write for the episode. 34 minutes of entire score. Actually, I stand corrected. There's 21 pieces of music in the show. In the second column, 15. That's 15 pieces of original music that you have to write. And so that total number is 25 minutes. So for this one episode of Jessica Jones, there was 25 minutes of score. A normal time for doing that is about 5 days. You have to kind of put that together, and then you have to kind of play it back for them, and then they have a big review process, which we'll go over a little bit of. But I always take that number, and I divide it by the number of days that you have. In other words, if you have 5 days, you have to sort of say to yourself, I'm going to put 5 minutes of music together. I'm going to compose 5 minutes, at least 5 minutes a day. You know, it's kind of a relief to it, because you know you have to do it, but when it's a high number, it can give you some stress, as my wife would tell you. Anyway, so now I'm going to go into the showing a little bit about Homeland and some of the music things, and then we're going to get into a little bit of the playing parts. Probably one of the most important parts of the job when you're scoring something is, first of all, after you decide where the music's going to go, is you want to really pay attention. For me, this is me talking. What do you, when you're watching a scene, what are you feeling when you watch it? When you're watching the show, what is happening? You really only have one chance to see it for the very first time. Like when you saw Star Wars 2 months ago, that first time you saw it, when you see it again, you know what it is. You've seen it, but that very first time you see something, you have immediate reactions to something. You know, and whatever you're feeling, I think, is always of value, whether you use it or not. So I always pay attention to it. So I'm going to play this scene without score, without any music, and then we'll play it with what the score ended up being in it. This is a scene at the end of...
It was Bill Wall.
This is at the scene at the end of... excuse me, I'm sorry. This is the scene at the end of season 2. And there's a memorial service, a burial service, and then these two main characters sneak away for a kiss. So
it was Bill Walden who championed a fledgling drone program, which has since degraded Al-Qaeda to the point of irrelevance. And it was Bill Walden who laid the groundwork for the operations that took out Osama bin Laden and Abu Nazir.
Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar.
decided. I want to be with you.
Well, now or...
بسم الله وعلى سنة رسول الله.
Amen.
We honor your husband for all he has done for this agency and for this great country.
What made you change your mind?
You did. What's wrong?
Nothing.
Why the sad look then?
Not sad. The opposite. That's weird.
What?
Somebody moved my car.
What are you talking about?
I didn't park it there. I parked in lot C.
Oof.
And the pres-
Anyway, something bad happens there, which you'll have to just watch the show if you want to see what happens. So there was a scene that was almost 3 minutes long. So if we were just, what are the things you felt? What are the things, what did, there's no wrong answer, but anybody feel anything? Huh? Slow, that's right, that does happen, it feels a little slow. What was the biggest moment in the scene, one of the bigger moments? What was the climax of the scene, so to speak, one of the climaxes? Yeah, that's when it starts to build up to that big, and we don't know the story, some of you may not know the story, but that kiss, that's them, they have never really truly had a moment together, and now that was sort of a total moment of joining. And it was a real payoff, not only for the story, but for the audience, you know. The challenge of the scene is that you have a memorial service happening for a presidential candidate, I mean a vice president, and then you have a memorial service for a terrorist who is being afforded proper burial rights at sea. And then they sneak away for this sort of, and if you, there's things, there are little clues in here, when they, this sort of like, let's get out of here. You know, there's a little bit of that going on. And then they go back here and there's a little bit of stealing away. There's a little bit of his smile. A little bit of, I mean, Damien and Lewis and Claire Danes are such great actors, but there's a lot of behavior going on. You know, there's a lot of great behavior. And you can choose as a composer to either play it, I mean, I'm not talking about when he smiles, you know, blah, you know, happy chord or something, it's just something to kind of take into the process as you watch this, but in the end, you have to write a piece of music, a complete piece of music, and the scene has an arc to it, it's a very long arc, and this is a show that is scored extraordinarily minimally, it's scored with just very light textures, sound design, some string work, although the budgets for that show doesn't allow for a lot of live string recording, but the next example will show that. So anyway, those are the things that happen. So when building the scene, there's a sort of, I always look at sort of these, there are these moments that unfold over time, and I chose to connect all these moments. But then the kiss happens, and then the kiss is really a big payoff, and that's a payoff that I think that in the music can really kind of take ownership of that moment. And then, but then you have the challenge of maintaining the scene when they go back to the memorial service. And you say to yourself, well, musically you go back to the solemnity of the service. It was decided when we were looking at it and during the spotting session that, you know what, let's keep the embers of that kiss going. You know, even though we're not seeing it, it's just the release of it is so nice and it's forgiving. So anyway, this is a, I don't think they always, I always
Bill
think,
Walton.
I always think they mix the show a little too, low with the music. I mean, every composer thinks that. So, but I'm going to play this with the music. It'll be a little softer, but then other examples will be louder.
Bill Walton, who championed the fledgling drone program, which has since degraded Al-Qaeda to the point of irrelevance. And it was Bill Walden who laid the groundwork for the operations that took out Osama bin Laden and Abu Nazir.
السلام علينا وعلى عباد الله الصالحين
الله اكبر الله اكبر الله اكبر الله اكبر
I want to be with you.
Well, now or...
I don't need to tell you the word that they said, right? Just a couple things about the spotting. You know, that they worked really hard when to bring it in. Like when she goes, "Hey, let's go," then it sneaks in. You know, if you played it over the speech and then she says, "Let's get out of here," if you played the solemnity of it over the speech and then she says, "Let's get out of here," that escape moment for them wouldn't have played as strong, you know? And also we duck out, there is an explosion, I can tell you that. There's a big boom. And we decided, pull the music out. And she says, "Oh, F," you know, and it's back to stillness. And then that made the ba-boom all the more powerful. So these are like choices that are being crafted on stage. What I wanted to show you was an alternate version of this scene. Now, we just talked about all the moments story-wise that you wanted to hit, but this very same scene actually could be interpreted very differently if you wanted to. For example, instead of them sneaking away for a kiss, they could. What if they were suicide bombers, and that they were going away to actually do some damage? In other words, what was that? What if that was the unit of intention there? And then you say, "Okay, we're doing the burial, and then they're going away, and then they're going to kiss, and then they're going to go," you know. And this is just an example of I put together a piece that basically plays the same scene, same actor, same performance, but the music is now going to completely change the texture of the meaning of the story.
It was Bill Walden who championed the fledgling drone program, which has since degraded Al-Qaeda to the point of irrelevance. And it was Bill Walden who laid the groundwork for the operations that took out Osama bin Laden and Abu Nazir.
السلام علينا وعلى عباد الله الصالحين
Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar.
So the music is telling a completely different tale. You know, I want to be with you right now could mean, here we go, bam, you know, I mean, and so that's probably the funnest part of the gig is sometimes you can take an approach to something and inject a level of subtext to it that could be kind of rocking and fun, you know. That would never have gotten approved. I don't know, which version do you like better? Does anybody like the second one better? Because that wasn't the one that survived, but... Yes? Someone... Oh, I thought someone said excuse me. Anyway, so now I'm going to play a couple of things out of Logic. Does anybody here use a Logic and Finale? And yeah. So I'm gonna come back to Homeland for some of the live stuff, but I wanted to show a little bit about the live recording process. This is a very, very crude diagram, but this is really how it's been done since the movie days, since the moviola days, and since film. Composer, he has an orchestrator, or he does it himself. Orchestrator goes to the copyist goes to live recording session, you record it and goes on to the mix stage. What's happening nowadays is oftentimes they just don't, except for The Simpsons, Star Trek, and shows that have live budgets, Family Guy, a lot of shows do not have the funds for a full orchestra. What they do is they allocate money for strings or brass or for things that, you know, and you have to kind of fill in the other part of it with, you know, with samplers and synths and so forth like that. That is a very common way that we work. And so this is just sort of a flow chart where, in addition to the top part is the live part, what you've normally already done when you're writing for live musicians. The lower part is where you're doing the synth and sound design part, what you do in Logic, and then you print that into either a Pro Tool session or whatever. And then those, both your synth stuff and your live stuff that you've done goes to the stage, and then the live performances replace the samplers from the strings. And I wanted to show an example of how that worked. This was an episode. It's funny, just before, has anybody seen the TV show Bones? Has anybody watched it? Has anybody ever seen it? Yeah. Okay. That show, it's been on 11 years, and I joined it after 3. I just found out about an hour before that the show got renewed for 12th and final year. So it's very rare to have a show go on that long, so I thought this is kind of cool. This was a scene from their 200th episode. Now, this couldn't be any more different from Homeland in terms of sound, music. An episode that was filmed in the style of a Bernard Herrmann, an Alfred Hitchcock film. And they wanted a Bernard Herrmann, Lynn Murray kind of execution. Which means that the music is incredibly more present in terms of character, in terms of style, in terms of flourishing and so forth. And so I'm going to play a version of this scene. I'm going to play this scene down, and then I'm going to show you. And by the way, the MIDI file, the actual notes that I played are here. I mean, I can't play them all because the computer's too slow, but the printed stems are up here. So I'm going to play this scene just so you can get an idea of...
Now!
Oops, am I okay here? So this is the finale sequence. This is the big moment where the bad persons are going to fly away. And if you don't, if you'll indulge me, we'll play it dry for a bit so you can kind of see.
Unconscious, but not dead yet. We'll dump her over the ocean to finish her off.
That's gonna be excellent. Time to board.
Go, go, go! Hurry! Get this bucket of bolts moving now! Go!
Great directing in this episode, right? I mean, the shots.
Lewis, don't I pay you when you couldn't give me a door that works?
I didn't know you wanted the luxury getaway package.
Oh, shut up and help me.
And who flies the plane?
Right out of North by Northwest, that shot, right? So I broke the queue into two parts. This is where the new queue will begin, just so you know.
Thank you, darling. I mean, Temperance. Now, we're all gonna stop fighting.
What is that racket? What blazes is going on back here? Uh-oh.
Don't just stand there, Lindbergh. Do something.
Riveting, right?
Don't even think about it.
They replaced the screen, don't worry about that. All right, it's almost over.
Did she?
Greed has that effect on people. But you solved the case, Detective.
And now we're going to die.
Oh no, I would never let that happen.
They live. So this is a very, there's not a lot of dialogue in there. And the music is, again, because they wanted it kind of in a Herman-esque way, it really has to be more, you know, flourishing and so forth. So, but we weren't going to be in a position to use a 40, 50 piece, 60 piece orchestra. So I did lobby to ask them if I could have a string ensemble. And because I really needed to have the kind of expressiveness of the string, I just knew that it was going to be that kind of a writing. So this is the beginning of the cue. Oh, and also, you know, as you saw it dry, you were one thing I think is. By the way, the director of this was David Boreanaz, the star of the show. He directed the episode, and even without music, you're still kind of giggling. That speaks to how strong the episode was, because there wasn't any gags in it or anything. But they're playing it kind of campy, and so the idea was to not be to take itself too seriously. Although you had to still play it like an honest situation, but this is just one of the stems. These are great players. There's a little gag there when he looks up with the, huh? I don't think so. So I thought it would be cool to play this scene. Because what you're going to hear is you're going to hear the live strings mixed in, but the other parts, the brass, regrettably, the brasses and some of the, and most of the percussion is playing out of, as they say, out of the box. But this was one of the more stylized episodes, which was a lot of fun to do. And from a music point of view, they were very happy, and I was happy they were happy. So this is the scene. I will just show you two more little things. Whenever you see big moments, like with the plane, with the cameras sweeping and stuff, these were really great opportunities for music. Like when he starts to load up the plane, there's not a lot going on there, but there's a great panning shot there. And then obviously when you see the cavalry come in the form of that rider. Anyway, so enjoy. We'll play this down.
The Braga house is empty. Where's the maid?
No idea. No idea where Miss Brennan or Booth are either.
Pre-lap.
Get this cover off the ground! Move it! her. Do something.
You get the idea. It's the all the things that are kind of like heroic and everything's really like way, way out there. The humor gets played and so just so you can kind of see a little bit of the process. Those parts, for example, the string writing parts, they existed. Bum ba da bum 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 bum. You know that opening. Oh, those look like squiggles and stuff, but what they eventually did is, you export that data, you export that MIDI file, and it has your music parts in it, and I'm sure you've already been doing this, but I handed it to my orchestrator, who basically cleaned up the MIDI file, and then, actually, he didn't really do much orchestration to it, because it was pretty fleshed out in the, it was pretty fleshed out in the sequence itself. This was that. Forgive me, my eyes. So you can kind of see it, but just so you know, so what they ended up playing was. So anyway, that was a fun gig. I wish it could have wish we could have had it with everybody live. But I ended up doing it live later on with an orchestra. So that was for a concert piece. So that's an example of that. Okay, so I can go back to Homeland, or we could see more of the bones, or we could. Does anybody have any? Is anybody, we wiped out? Is everyone okay? All right. I'll go back to Homeland then, and then we could do, I'll do one more, some Homeland stuff, and then we can, or Jessica Jones too, I could do some of that. So I'm just going to give the briefest of demonstrations about analyzing a scene and making a choice and committing to something and going for it for better or for worse. And, I have always found it to be kind of fun to play scenes dry to see what people react to, what they think. And while I'm loading, does anybody have any questions? Go ahead. Oh, do we have to hand the mic around? Is that bad to do? I'm sorry. It's a great question. The question is do you deal with one person or more than one person? The answer is that there is, I have found in my experience, one person that does make the final decision, but they consult a lot of different producers along the way. So when I have people in the studio playing back a score, I'll have often the writer, I'll have the executive producer and another producer, and sometimes the picture editor. And sometimes they'll debate whether what I'm doing is working or not. Sometimes they might, you know, it's a moment of truth. You're playing it down. But when we kick it back and forth, there is one final person that says, I like it, we're going to keep it. There is an overriding authority. I have worked on shows where two people are in charge, and those shows don't do very well. It's just, it's two people in charge, everybody dies. It's there's just, you need to have somebody lead. I would dare say it's like a conductor, a beloved conductor, like I've been seeing Dudamel lately at the at Disney in Los Angeles. And there's a lot of, I just sense there's a lot of connection and devotion to his leadership and so forth. And when you're working on a show like Homeland, they know the story and they know the brain trust, and they know that you want to sort of marry yourself to their vision of what the story they want to tell. I would never put a piece like you just heard in Homeland. I'd be escorted off the premises, you know. I mean, but you have to kind of find a language and feel safe enough to do the kind of exploring that you want to do. But yeah, there's generally, a playback is when you sit, you play it down. And by the way, sometimes you play things down before you've recorded live. In other words, you have to give them a very, very good demo. It didn't used to be like that, but now you have to play things that sound pretty completed. And then you go back and forth. Yes? It all depends, but I will say on average, on like for Homeland or for this, that Bones episode, that episode was given to us the Wednesday before Thanksgiving. And it, as my wife would tell you, and then we had to mix it on Tuesday after Thanksgiving. So nobody had any turkey really to speak of, but we just had to get it done. And the session was the following Tuesday. And we recorded, I think, 18 minutes of live music. Not all of it was done live, but it was, but yeah, a general turnaround time is about a week. I mean, 5 days to score, 1 day for review, and 1 day for mixing. It's different for episodic comedies, that like for 30-minute shows, because the music needs are different. You know, there are more stings, and it's a more of a library gig sometimes. So we're here. I'm going to play this one scene from Homeland. This is from season 4. And again, I'll ask you to just pay attention to what you're feeling as you watch it. This is a scene where Mandy Patinkin, has anybody watched the show? Has anybody ever seen it? Yeah. This is a sequence where he is making a decision to, he's on the run, he's one of the good guys, he's on the run, he's about to be captured. He decides he doesn't want to be captured, so he's going to kill himself. And Carrie talks him out of killing himself, and here's how it plays down.
Too many.
No, I'm here in the ops room. I am looking at the screen and I am telling you it is not hopeless. There is a way. Saul, we will thread the needle, you and I. We will get you home, but you need to put that gun down and focus. You need to do exactly what I say. Saul? Saul?
There are special forces that are not come to the moment. We can't.
Saul, they're waiting for you at the rendezvous. Don't let them down.
You hear me, Saul? You listening? They should be there right now.
Saul, you're in a courtyard. You need to exit it now. He's moving. Okay. So at the alleyway, you're going to take a right.
That's the way it came.
Well, we're gonna retrace your steps a bit.
What now?
Up ahead, there's 1, 2, 3 buildings. Rear left.
Carrie.
Don't worry, I see them. There should be a door to your left.
That's locked.
Try the next one.
No good.
Okay.
Sorry about that. That was an anomalous sound. I don't know where that's from. That wasn't very good.
I'm in.
Keep moving. You're looking for an exit across the building.
Where?
To your left, and then your right, probably.
Let's hit one.
Good. That'll take you out to a street, and the park is 2 blocks away.
Okay.
Just keep moving.
I am. Carrie!
With friends like these, what happened was, is she knew he was gonna not be taken prisoner, so she lied to him and convinced him to run. He believed her that she was going to deliver him to an escape, but she deliberately sent him right to being captured. It was the only way that she could save his life. So it was kind of a very intense scene when I first saw it. And the thing that I just wanted to make note of is, here's a guy who is in such distress, and I guess this is the question I would ask you if you had to score it, is what are we playing at this point? He makes a decision to not kill himself, and he's been on the run. So there's a couple valid ways to go here. One,
don't worry, I see them. There should be a door to your left.
That's locked.
Try the next one.
So there's all this act. I'm going to talk over this. There's all this action.
Okay, I'm in.
The camera's following.
You're looking for an exit across the building.
Where?
To your left, and then you're...
Very quick editing.
Let's hit one.
Running out of breath. There's all these clues. It's like, yes, I'm going to make it.
The park is 2 blocks away.
So one approach was to play it kind of like of the drama of, will he get captured? Will he not get captured? Kind of intense, you know, kind of like, you know, kind of a dark and weighted and brooding. And when I saw it, the choice I thought might be a little more interesting for the guys was, he's almost home. Like this idea, through his eyes, he's almost going to be delivered. There's a bit of hope, even though he's frazzled. So you think to yourself, well, during that moment between when you're breaking this piece, when you're thinking of composing a piece.
So you're in a courtyard.
So he goes, he's...
You need to exit it.
He comes out of that big moment of the gun. And then when he starts running, there's your transition. There's your moment where it changes. So I just wanted to point out, this is again, I hate coming back to the word spotting, but...
So?
There's moments where you say, well, what do you play him putting the gun to his head? Sorry, just bear with me.
He must see them. Too many.
No, I'm here.
Now, some people, there was some discussion about having it come in.
Too many.
No, I'm here. I'm here in the ops room. I am...
Just going to give myself a little better view here.
No, I'm here.
Now, this is not the kind of show where you would go, you know, when he puts the gun to his, you know, you know, this would be kind of, you know, on the nose.
I'm here. I'm here.
You know, that just would make you start to giggle. And,
I'm here.
You know, it's just,
I'm here.
It's just not the kind of show that it is. But it would work on another show. It's just not going to work on that show.
No,
So you have to speak in the language of the show. Sometimes the idea is that you just... This show, because the acting is so good, can function so texturally, minimally, that you can literally just add a simple sound. you know, you could actually get away with putting that in there.
It is not hopeless.
Too many.
No, I'm here. I'm here in the ops room. I am looking at the screen and I am telling you it is not hopeless. There is a way. Saul? Saul, we will thread the needle, you and I. We will get you home, but you need to put that gun down and focus. You need to do exactly what I say. Saul?
It's just one element, but already it brings you into the drama a little bit more. And when I looked at the scene, it was so heartbreaking because here's a guy who's really facing taking himself out. He's sort of in between this is the kind of thinking that happens to me, for better or for worse, is he's kind of in between two worlds here. He's like, is he gonna do it or not? He's sort of in this in-between space. And sometimes you just say, I'm gonna commit to that kind of in-between space for this moment for him. You know, this, and that's just a choice. It's not the right or the wrong choice, it's just a choice.
So I'm ready.
No, I'm here. I'm here in the ops room. I am looking at the screen and I am telling you it is not hopeless. There is a way. Saul? Saul, we will thread the needle, you and I. We will get you home, but you need to put that gun down and focus. You need to do exactly what I say. Saul? Saul?
I pulled it out, but I'm trying to play some of his, as I keep going with it, you start realizing there's a loneliness. There's such an aloneness to this man's position. You know, no matter how much he's reaching out to him, there's still this kind of aloneness. Anyway, so that I could build upon that part of it and go farther with it. But then he makes a decision to stop, and I'll just concentrate a little bit more on this area. By the way, in the episode, we didn't play the gun going to the head. We didn't play him doing that. We actually brought it in, and I thought it was the greatest choice. We brought it in when he brings the gun down.
Saul, they're waiting for you at the rendezvous. Don't let them down.
Because it was so powerful on its own.
You hear me, Saul? You listening? They should be there right now.
Saul, you're in a courtyard. You need to exit it now.
Okay.
It's moving.
I'm using a click now.
Okay. So at the alleyway, you're gonna take a right.
That's the way I came.
Well, we're gonna retrace your steps a bit.
Okay, so just bear with me for a second, because this is the meat and potatoes kind of boring. You know, if none of you were in this room and I was by myself, this is how it kind of goes for me. So I'm gonna just try this. I had this idea, I was looking at it earlier. When he starts to go on the move, try something over his walking.
Okay. So at the alleyway, you're gonna take a right.
That's the way I came.
Well, we're gonna retrace your steps a bit.
Okay, already I'm gonna change it.
Up ahead, there's a 1, 2, 3 buildings. Your left. Don't worry, I see them. There should be a door to your left.
That's locked.
Try the next one.
So good.
Okay, I'm in.
Keep moving.
That's it, Wanda.
Good. I'll take you out to the street, and the park is 2 blocks away.
Okay.
Just keep moving.
So what I'm going for is I'm going for a sense of build. I'm going for a sense of hope, a sense of growing. And this is only the first pass, but I just you'll start to get the idea that I have is that I'm going to start warming it up with other textures to sort of give it a sense of movement. I'm going to bring the dialogue down a little bit. I think it's a little hot.
There should be a door to your left. Don't worry, I see them. There should... Three buildings.
That's the way it came.
Well, we're gonna retrace your steps a bit.
Idea is that it kind of you're kind of feeling a sense of hope and optimism that just doing something quarterly there, just kind of simple, but there are little clues as when he enters the building. It informed me a little bit that he was getting closer, that maybe he was getting closer. I'm literally playing the unit of that he's going to be saved, and so then at that point maybe I would add and I would maybe replace this with a violin. I'd make it even a little bit more hopeful. And as a matter of fact, before I do that, maybe I would actually even put in I have some kind of these. That's just a kind of a pad going through some sort of tremolator. Providing a little bit more sense of
okay, I'm in.
I like the idea of playing it even with more energy as we get closer to the end. So, and these are things that kind of come out to me as I work on it. I don't know how much this happens in the way others work, but for me now, there's a part of me that says I want to have a sense that he's really possibly going to make it. Let's see if I have a. I'm sorry, I'm just going to look around one more second, and then I promised. Yeah, here's another. Something like that, or I could grab a... I have a little... This is a dulcimer sound.
Ah!
But I'm not mixing anything, I'm just kind of going on the fly here, but you'll get the joke. So I'm going to bring even a little bit more.
Okay, okay, I'm in.
So now it's...
Try the next one.
Okay.
So it gets even warmer in the second part of that, and then maybe one last, I'm so sorry, but just one last thing. Just sometimes a little, now booms are very stereotypical, but when he's getting closer, and then here's another great indication as to whether you know, if sometimes you get so close to something, you realize you're botching it. You know, you're not following the arc. So then I back away and play it from the top.
Three buildings.
That's the way I came.
Well, we're gonna retrace our steps a bit.
What now?
Up ahead, there's a 1, 2, 3 buildings. To your left.
Okay.
Don't worry, I see them. There should be a door to your left.
I'll play what piece that ended up in there. This is the piece that actually I ended up surviving in the show.
That's the way I came.
Well, we're gonna retrace our steps a bit. You need to exit. Saul. Saul, you're in a courtyard. You need to exit it now. Okay, so at the alleyway, you're gonna take a right.
That's the way I came.
Well, we're gonna retrace our steps a bit.
What now?
Up ahead, there's 1, 2, 3 buildings. To your left.
Okay.
Don't worry, I see them. There should be a door to your left.
You're fucking lying!
So, that's the... We could have a much longer discussion about, you know, getting out of the way of dialogue for certain things and so forth, but and I have other things that we can certainly show, but that kind of gives you a bit of the round robin view of the process in terms of episodic, commercial free scoring. But it's very much similar to Bones. Well, Bones is commercial, but why don't we have questions, unless is there anything that I've confused you completely about that you need to be... Yes. Hello. Oh, I'm glad. Thank you. I'm glad. It's a great question. The question was the template that I'm using. Is it a default template? How does that happen? Every series has a different template. Jessica Jones, for example, has basses and drums and more smaller kits. You start with sort of a bass template, and then it kind of evolves out with each episode that you work on. Or if it's a singular project, like for me in this miniseries about the Kennedys, it was a more anthemic brass setup. But there is sort of a static setup that I have, with sort of standard things that I always use, like piano and strings for doing things of that nature. But the sound design aspect and anything that's sort of unique to that show, in Homeland, for example, this sound is, there's a, I don't want to bog the Q&A down, but I had this sound. This was a, that's a sound that I found that I used in Homeland to kind of play Brody's is he a good guy or a bad guy kind of energy. But I don't use it in Bones, you know. So there is a static sort of palette, but then there's customized special stuff on the edges that become part of the show's sound. Yeah. Yes, sir.
One question I had was, so since you focus on shows, series, mm-hmm. and things instead of feature films, which is what I've spent most of my time thinking about, but now yes, I've been thinking about lately. So with shows, you have less time to do more music, and the fear is that with the focus being towards quantity instead of maybe quality, you'll have less time with music, less time to make music that you like, maybe, or I don't know. You feel rushed. Do you ever do you like doing show music more than, I mean, like, so series and shows, or would you like to be doing feature films, but you got stuck doing this? Or
that's a good. No, you know, when I started working on 24, I was very fortunate enough to get some Emmy recognition for that show at the end of season two, and my agent said, who I had, you know, said you should leave that show now and focus on features. I have done a couple of films. I did a couple of smaller films, one that came out last year called Small Time, and I did a couple of documentaries about. One is about a Buddhist teacher that I admired and so forth. But I didn't make any conscious choice about it, to be perfectly straight about it. I'd love to, if I was getting onto a film, as I did on a couple of occasions, it's great. What I love about the television or the delivery world of this is it is intense. It's very intense, but I guess it's good for me because I can be a real procrastinator. There's just no procrastinating in this line of work. You have to kind of really find innovative ways to do things. I think the television and film world, certainly from a creative point of view, are merging a bit. You have David Fincher, for example, directing and exec producing House of Cards, and you're getting a level of elegance to music. I've always thought television music, back to Earl Hagen days, was fantastic. But you're getting even more richness from the film world crossing into the television world and vice versa. And we're watching on so many different kinds of devices now. It's kind of it's just not a TV versus film kind of thing anymore. I have people telling me that they watched all of Jessica Jones in their bed, you know, on a tablet. Good for them, you know. I'm very happy about it. But there's no regret. There's no regret, and I just as long as I'm working on something that's inspiring and thankfully not. What I haven't had a situation where I felt I've had to sacrifice something. or settle for something less creatively. Look, Bones, for example, the TV show. We've done 200 episodes. Now, you might think, I think we've covered the rotting corpse, playful pizzicato sonority over that show. We have, but I work with two other composers on it. It's hard work. You have to make every show original and unique, and so we enjoy it even to this day. Yeah, please.
Hey. How are you? Sorry, I came into the latter half of this.
That's all right.
So I don't know if my question has already been addressed.
I wanted you to sing, by the way. We met in L.A., and she sang, what did we sing together?
It's like Daydream.
That's right.
Like some jazz.
Yeah, and I wanted her to sing something from Homeland, but I couldn't get the clip together in time. That would have been really great to show the live recording. Next time, I'm sorry.
So next time, for you, sure thing.
What's going on?
I was wondering, so with like such fast turnover and working with different people, mm-hmm. how is it collaborating? Because I feel like as musicians, we have our different ideas and sometimes you get married to them. But in a field where you have to compromise to make results, how do you find yourself working through that in different ways?
When I'm collaborating with a guitar player like George Deering, who played on the Homeland main title, I will sit him down and he'll go nuts on beautiful parts, and I rarely do I ever come to a situation where we don't find some sort of common ground somewhere. If he gets attached to some way of playing and I have to switch it, or he wants to switch it, I find that the really pro guys don't really have any ego about it. The trumpet player who played on Jessica Jones, I needed a mellow trumpet sound. He kept doing it, and I said, I'm sorry, I just need something a little softer. And he says, I got it, you know. Those are the people that I gravitate towards because I serve at the pleasure of the producers. I'm hiring them to play my stuff and they want to get it right for me. The really great guys just want it, and women, I don't mean to use a pronoun there. We find a way forward. If we have really a creative rub sometimes, sometimes I have it with my music editor. My music editor, sometimes thinks maybe we should start a cue later, and I said, no, I like it starting here. But he's on the mix stage fighting it out with producers, making sure the producers are happy. He says, I think we can solve the problem by moving this part, and I may not want to do it or take the suggestion. And sometimes it gets a little heated, sometimes something gets changed and you're disappointed. But the ones that I think are really the survivors are the ones that don't hold on, that their focus is on the bigger picture. And it's a good question, because if I do encounter any kind of weird energy like that, you just tend to not work with them. You just tend to kind of avoid, not out of malice, you just say, I just kind of remember that being an unpleasant experience. But thankfully, knock wood, that's been very few for me. You have a good attitude, I remember that. You Hey there.
Hi. How is the copyright for your music when you're hired to do something? Do you own it? Can you make a gig out of it if you want?
Yeah. Composers who are hired for, I would imagine, this is true for games, it's true for most, any kind of work to picture. It's work for hire. So you are the composer, and so you would get appropriately credited performing rights credit, like ASCAP, BMI, CSAC. But the publisher is the studio, the people who own the publishing. So, if, for example, if I wanted to make an album of Homeland music, I would need their consent. They're my themes. I own the themes, but my use of them in a soundtrack album, they do have the power over that. That is what they're publishing control. I have never ever encountered a studio that would not encourage someone to make an album to further promote a show that's popular, so it rarely comes up to be an issue. I do own the publishing to some smaller projects in which the salaries were very low, but they offer you the publishing rights, so you can own the music and reuse it wherever you wish. Does that help? Yeah, please.
Right here.
Oh, hi, hello again.
Two questions?
Two?
Okay. You mentioned Gustavo Dudamel.
Excuse me? Yeah, Dudamel. Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
So LA Symphony, You can get a budget to work with them.
Well, the LA Phil, my understanding, I don't want to be speaking out of place of authority here, there's a lot of, the LA Phil is its own curriculum and its own schedule, but the Star Wars score, for example, was played by LA music, an entire group of an LA orchestra that I don't know if they were part of the LA Phil. There's a lot of working orchestral musicians that are working on every show, working, you know, the really good players are always called up. Because they're working so much, my understanding is that they're not part of the symphony full time. I just don't know the answer to that question, but I do know that there are separate contractors in Los Angeles that book when I wanted string players. They knew exactly who to call, and now I work with these people, and now I want them every time because they're so cooperative and they're so great. You know, again, it's about the people that they look at the music and they play it like they've always known it, which is really cool. And there's a lot of anxiety sometimes. You know, you go up there to conduct it, and you hope it's going to sound right. You do. I mean, you don't. You got to work it out, and they're very patient. And so, but yes, you can draw budgets, and there are a lot of TV shows that have budgets for live. And it's people predicted 30 years ago when the first samplers came out. The very first sampler that ever got made that got dropped off here at NEC was this big 200-pound Kurzweil digital piano. And I thought, oh, that's it. You know, that's it for the piano and the orchestra. It just didn't. There were things that happened over 30 years, technologically speaking, but it didn't remove the desire to hear live musicians. If anything, I think it's increased.
The second one was when a series is shot, they do maybe, I don't know, 13 episodes for a year or something like that, right?
It depends, but yeah, 13. Yeah.
So they also film 7, 3, 1.
Out of sequence?
Yes, completely out of sequence because locations and artists, actors, logistics, you know.
Sometimes they do.
Dictate that. So when you get, what do you get? You get a DVD of 3 segments, and they say you have 2 days for this.
I just worked on an episode of Elementary, this Sherlock Holmes show on CBS, and there was an entire chase sequence involving a dog chasing a man through a park, and it opens the show. And it wasn't available; they hadn't shot it yet. So what you do is you get slugs. You get missing scenes. You'll have the show played down. You saw a couple of them. It said scene 48 close up. There were some inserts that they have to do. When I worked on a video game, on this James Bond game, Everything or Nothing, there were a lot of scoring all over the place, where you're scoring certain missions that they decide, you know what, we don't like this mission, isn't playing well, we're going to change it, and you're scoring out of sequence all the time, in my opinion, in the gaming world. But you have to go with something, and if there's missing scenes, you just have to sort of wait it out, and sometimes you get asked to write something for a scene that doesn't exist yet, and I have done that, almost like an animation of some sort, you know.
So when you show, let's see, your first draft,
yeah,
that you think is
gonna yeah, it's okay. When you show the first draft,
when that happens, where do you show up? You go to a meeting, or they come to your studio?
Well, it happens two ways now. On Homeland, they come to the studio. And they come to the studio and they play the whole show down. If there's 15 minutes of music, they play 55 minutes. They want to see it running in real time. That's a very rare thing, I find. What people are doing more nowadays on most of the other projects is you're making QuickTime movies. You're making running movies of what you want them to review. I find that in the dawning stages of a project, when you're first finding the sound of it, the going back, having them come personally is preferable, even if it's more difficult. Right. Because sometimes people will say, I don't like this, this isn't working. And you'll say, well, what's not working? And it could be just a bell or a triangle, it could be something actually manageable, you know, but sometimes when you're reviewing QuickTime movies and people get to type their responses, it can, you know, there could be like a fire going on, you know, and in reality it's a little bit more manageable. So it's an old school way. It's an older school way to have them with you when you're going back and forth, but the QuickTime movies is the way it is. For most, and you learn how to adjust with that too. You do other versions.
Now, if you get approved, do you get the luxury to sit down with the editor and work with him when he's doing the cutting and adjusting?
Sometimes.
Sometimes.
Sometimes,
that's
yeah.
a great thing.
Depends, yeah. Yeah. Cheers.
Okay.
Hey.
Thank you.
See you. Sometimes. Yeah, I think you were next, yeah. Yes.
What are they paid from?
Yes.
Because if you don't own your publishing, right?
That's right. The question was about music editors and who pays them.
And what is the role of the music editor?
Yes, the music editor. The short answer is they prepare the they actually keep an eye on the music and they act as your emissary on the mix stage. A lot of times you're not able to be on the mix stage. You're already working on the next episode, and there has to be an advocate for the music score on the stage. Otherwise, it is a bit of a political environment sometimes. Sound effects and dialogue get pushed, and the music kind of gets in the background. And then the music guy has to say, "Excuse me, but the music has to come up here," you know. And so a music editor is responsible. He lobbies for that, and he also has to answer if at the 11th hour they make a picture cut, and all of a sudden your 3-minute cue is down to 2.5. They will edit your stems, they will edit your audio, and instead of throwing it back to you. That's one of the things. Music editors are generally put into the budget of a project. My music editor has a separate contract with the studio. Sometimes if the project is particularly low paying, you are responsible for absorbing that fee for the music editor. Some people prefer sometimes to work without a music editor if need be. I always like to have a music editor because I just want to think about the writing, the music. He's on my behalf, but he also is on the producer's behalf. Sometimes the producer will say, I just don't like the way this is playing. Can you kind of fix it? And the composer's always going to say, but it's perfect, you know. But it's right, don't you see, dummy? You know. But I mean, and so he kind of, as a matter of fact, sometimes they prefer talking to the editor than the composer, because they don't want to have
the artist.
Yeah, I mean, and I don't have that. I'd like to think I don't have that kind of reputation, because I, you know, if they want to change something. As long as keeping them happy is important, but I'll just real quickly on the last. If you saw season 5 of Homeland, they gutted a cue that I wrote and replaced it with a piece of music that I'd written in a prior episode that they just preferred, and I just totally just broke my heart. You know, well, they did it after I left. You know, we played it down. Are we good? Yeah, we're happy. And then at the dinner that night for the cast and crew, someone said, "Hey, they went back to the." To something earlier, and I was like, "Oh, yeah," but it happens. Was it a disaster? No, it's just your ego. Sometimes you get kind of wound up.
Get any royalty for those the music in those episodes because you make the sound, habillage. How do you say?
Well, as the composer, you get. Royalties, yes.
You get.
Yes. As a matter of fact, I don't have a cue sheet with me, but every single piece of every show that exists has a legal document, a cue sheet.
Yeah.
The cue sheet lists every piece of music in that show. And there are two columns. One is for the composer and one is for the publisher. So the composer, presumably yourself, would be the person who would receive the revenues.
Okay. So even if you don't own any publishing, you have royalties.
Yes, and we're very grateful for that because it helps us reinvest in our business and so forth. It's very.
Is it good money?
Well, I'll put it to you this way. This is a longer discussion, but network television, for example, those rates are higher. Cable stations are catching up, but they're not quite there. And then there are some places where you're, you know, in the final frontier is the digital world, Netflix world, the streaming world. That has to be kind of worked out.
It's not set.
Not quite. But laws have to be rewritten. I mean, copyright laws were written back when it was radio and 3 channels of television. And it's just a different way that we consume entertainment now.
And can TV come and tell you, okay, yeah, you do the music for free, but you get royalties for that?
They can, yeah.
Do they do it?
Well, I've worked on pilot episodes. Pilot episodes are the first episodes where they pay very, very little. And if it goes to series, then you'll get the lion's share of the fee if it goes to series. But if it doesn't go to series, if it doesn't get picked up, then, you know, I tend to say yes, you know, because I want to work, especially if you want to work with the people.
Yeah.
So that's how, yeah.
Thank you.
Yes. Let me take one of yeah. And we.
Hi. Yeah. So I heard you talking about how you had an agent. It would be cool if you could try to tell us about what your agent does, and then also, did you as soon as you got out to LA and started doing sound design work, did you get an agent, or like at what point did that become part of your?
I'll tell you how it happened for me, and everyone will have a different story. I was mentoring under Mark Snow. Mark Snow was the composer of the show The X-Files, which just recently started re-airing again. I was sort of an intern slash composer apprentice. A show came up that he couldn't do, and he recommended me for it, plain and simple. You don't know how to thank someone for, you don't know how to thank someone for giving you that opportunity. But that's what opened that door. I had a project which was given to me. I still had to prove myself, and there were certainly times when I didn't know if I was going to keep the job because they were wary of hiring someone who didn't have a lot of experience, which is the whole thing. I can't get experience unless I'm work, but I can't work unless I have experience, the whole loop there. But once I had the series, an agent took interest in me because I, to be perfectly blunt about it, it was going to bring them money. It was going to bring them business. And that began the relationship with the agency I've been with for 18 years. It does happen where when you work with another composer, they end up finding an agent and growing and doing themselves. I think I cannot speak more highly about the idea of shadowing and learning from another composer, because that's how I did it. And the agent, what they do for you is they do, there's a lot of debate about the value of agents. I value my agent. They look at what your desires and needs are in the world and where you want to go artistically, and they try to make that happen. You know, some people complain about their agents not doing enough for them, and it's a rich topic over a martini, perhaps, that you and I can discuss, but or two. But I mean, honestly, my agent, I like my agents. I do. I like them. That's why I've been with them for almost 18 years.
They
huh? Yeah, they do. Yes, they do. They do. And sometimes their hands are tied. I mean, you know, agents can only do so much. You know, if you want to work on a show and they say they're offering X and you say, well, I want Y, eventually you're going to have to decide whether to walk away from it or keep it, you know. And the agents will always, of course, want you to keep it because they want to keep you busy and so forth. Yeah.
Thank you for being so generous.
Oh, it's a uh-huh. Well, I appreciate it. Being back here has been a real crazy joy. It's nostalgic and new at the same time. And I really enjoyed, look, I've got to just say, I really enjoyed being here and learning here. I have to just tell you once that I got hired for a job in LA because of my New England Conservatory pin, you know, the alma mater pin. I was at a trade show. I was looking for electronics gear. And a guy named Brad Naples, who was making a big computer product, he was president of a company that made a product called the Synclavier. At the time, it was the instrument used by Stevie Wonder and Chick Corea and Herbie Hancock, and a fellow conservatory person, my friend Eric Gray, was working for the company at the time. Anyway, he said, you go to the conservatory, New England Conservatory? I said, yeah. And he said, what do you do? I said, play piano. He goes, do you know MIDI and computers? And I said, yeah, which was a complete lie. And he says, why don't you interview for a job for an LA product specialist position? You know, and I went to LA working as a computer support person for this music company. And that's how I met Mark Snow. So I had worked in the audio department here, where I learned technical things about stuff. And that came in really handy when I got hired by, I went from NEC to NED, New England Digital. It was kind of weird, but that's what happened. And then from there, I kept my head down and just, you know. But the NEC pin, wear it. I'm telling you, something will happen. It's crazy. It was crazy how that happened, but it did happen. So, go ahead.
Could you just tell us a little bit about the first meeting with the composer and the people who are going to decide whether the person is going to be the composer for the series, or how is it different?
I just had, there's a pilot I'm going to start working on next month, and I had to have a conversation on the phone with the director from Toronto. We had, and I didn't know him, I had to read the script, and it's an ABC pilot, and it's a discussion basically about what you think of the story. You know, what kind of, when you have the discussion, they want to hear your thoughts on what you think the music should be, you know? And you just have to sort of read the script, and then, like I was showing you those script things and so forth, and you glean from that sometimes, well, what kinds of things do they like? Now, before that meeting, I did look up the director, and I looked at the films that he did, and I listened to some of the scores that he did for those movies. So I kind of got a sense of his tone and his texture. I mean, research the people that you want to work with. And so there's always a little bit of nerves, I won't lie, when you're having a meeting with someone, because you wonder, is there a magic word like red or purple, you know, or something that gets you to get, I don't know what that is, but there's got to be a sense of good communication. You want to convey that you can work with that person. But I've taken interviews where I get it, and I've taken interviews where I haven't. And you get bummed for a second, but then there's no cosmic meaning to it. It's just, you know, you connected with someone more than another person, and vice versa on other occasions. But yeah, but you just gotta. I always find when you listen to the director, he'll say something that will really inform you. He'll say, I remember he said when I worked on the Sherlock Holmes thing, he said he used an adjective to describe the multi. He spun many plates at once. You know, Sherlock Holmes can observe things at once, and I just thought of Baroque music. When I was a conservatory student here, I remember having trouble playing fugues, you know, with the voices, keeping voices all together in the head, and that sort of became my idea for the show. I didn't know if it was going to work, but I shared that idea, and we followed it. You know, just bring whatever you can. I did some demos, yeah. I did some demos before I was hired. That does happen. Yeah, and sometimes you get called, I need a demo of 6 minutes of action. I need a demo of music by tomorrow morning. And, you know, you gotta have stuff ready to go. Yeah, it does happen. Yeah. Sure.
Hi. I have two short questions. One is based on my own experience composing for a short internet video.
Mm-hmm.
And it's much easier when you can discuss with the director or with the producer what can be the music idea.
Yes.
But sometimes they send you an example or something that's pre-recorded, and it's so hard to change their minds over that. They usually, you can try to add something different and a little bit of your personal, you know, thought, but they always gonna say, no, but can you actually, you know, do something more similar to the example we sent? And my second question is simple. In terms of internet short videos, how much do you think it's worth for, how much should we charge for it? I have a lot of trouble finding how to price my work in this sense.
Well, I'll answer the first part. You're talking about an eternal problem with composers, and that's the love that a director or a producer will have with a temp score. I worked on a ghost story TV show called Medium, and they dropped in the theme from The Godfather, you know, that da 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 da, and they loved it, and they wanted this sort of Italian kind of waltzy kind of thing, and I did something original that was not the theme from The Godfather, and they just couldn't be satisfied. And at one point I said, you know, you should just spend the money and license the piece, because there's just a certain magic to certain melodies that you're just not gonna, you just can't do it. And then at that point they said, well, we can't do that. And I said, well, then we have to kind of be open to another approach. What I'm beginning to think, this is just me talking to you now, is if I ever get hired for a show and I had a little bit of runway, a little bit of time, I would probably try to write a lot of music, you know, get some music going to them before I even see picture. Because then the picture editors would have some original content of yours, you know. Just ideas, right? Doesn't even have to be completed. But when you drop it into a rough cut, then all of a sudden they're living with something that's yours. They're living with something that's original. I mean, these are things that I'm thinking about trying to do. They've sometimes dropped in terrible temp music to a show, and they end up getting attached to lousy music. They say, I know it's lousy, but we're kind of attached to it now. Where does that leave you? I mean, it's a tough one. Unfortunately, I don't have a clear-cut answer for you. But you gotta protect yourself. You can't swim so close to something that they want that all of a sudden you're encroaching on the intellectual property rights of another. It's a danger. I have no idea what you charge for. I don't know. I mean, there's so many things I need to know. Like, how many did you score? 5 minutes, 10 minutes? I mean, do you get 5 minute film? I'm gonna have to. I'd have to do some research on that. I don't know. I apologize. I don't have an answer for it. I mean, if you're working on an ad campaign for something and there's some money there and you want to own your publishing, and there are little metrics that you can do to kind of protect your work. But I don't. I think the jury's out on that. I'm not quite sure. I'm sorry. Yeah. In the back.
Hi.
Hi.
I was just sort of wondering, and this might have been something I missed a while earlier. What the relationship is sort of between like the sample sounds you're playing versus like notational files.
Yes.
And I was curious sort of about like your starting point for a lot of these things. You mentioned like the sample sets, mm-hmm. but do you like come up with a lot of those on your own right away and then work with different matters, or how exactly does it work?
I have colleagues. One is a colleague named Trevor Morris, who actually has this brilliantly designed palette where, you know, the whole orchestra is kind of mapped out in he uses a program called Cubase. And so whenever he's writing for violin one, violin two, you know, it's all so elegantly put there. I do a lot of performing and playing, not notating with drawing. And so a lot of times, if I'm using a particular sound with a big fade in or a ramp or something, I'm always playing a little behind the beat. So when you look at a MIDI file, it actually looks a little odd. And so when I'm finished doing the music in a palette, I export that, and then my orchestrator does double duty. He cleans up the file for live performing, and then the notes are more or less there, and then we put ornamentation and phrasing and so forth. But yeah, it starts in Logic, and then it exports to, and for him, I think he uses Sibelius, and then from there he'll go to copyists, and then it will be for the Bones episode. That's how it worked. I did all the string writing in a Logic file, and then it went to Sibelius.
Yeah, and the file you showed us that had the string orchestra playing it, that finale file was from the orchestrator. You would sort of come up with the music, and then they put it realized into what the strings were.
Yeah, I think in that Bones episode, it was pretty fully realized. There wasn't really much. He didn't really orchestrate anything. Although when we did the full orchestra version for a concert, he fleshed it out and doubled some parts for me, and made it fuller. And I completely enjoyed it. He checked with me, and I thought it was a great idea, and so he actually did that. But for the string parts alone, there was really nothing to orchestrate. It was just to clean up the MIDI and make sure it printed right so that people could read it properly.
Great.
Right? Cool. Here, over there, and then you. And then, I don't know how much time we have, but I'll talk as long as you want, but I don't want to bore anybody.
Hi. So, this, you know, as like a freshman undergrad at NEC in composition, and, you know, what would be your advice for everybody who's like still not in school and kind of like, you know, do I really want to go into? Like, what are the values that NEC taught you, you know, like 20, 30 years later, mm-hmm. like when you look back at like your time at NEC?
I will tell you, and I mean this sincerely, that when I tell anybody out in the industry that I went to New England Conservatory, it is a generally very well-received, respected comment. And the reason why I say that is because it is synonymous with a caliber of talent. I think in the years since I've been here, and certainly before it, the level of talent of people at this institution has not wavered. If anything, it's just gone up. For me personally, I told this earlier today. I remember being told in my first freshman year I had to practice 7 hours a day on the piano, and I'd never done that ever. You know, and I was quite spooked by that. I was like, I'm not gonna make it. There was some sort of anxiety about that, about the commitment to it. But then you did. You know, you found some sort of discipline, and there's some sort of you bring some sort of real. I mean, I'm talking to people who are doing this, right? I mean, you're working so hard, and sometimes you're alone, and sometimes you're alone with insecurity about these things. To be very honest with you. And but you stay with it, and the school has that kind of encourages you to stay and find your voice and to find your path. This is to say nothing of the technical grounding, the actual education that you can sort of rely upon. Now, there are many film and TV composers that started from rock and roll and jazz and other mediums, which is as valid as any one. For me, it started with classical piano. That was continued when I got here. I had to take choir and things I didn't want to do, but but they are so valuable because I had to write a choir piece for an episode of Medium. I had to write some sort of Latin mass kind of thing. And I had sung the Latin mass, you know, back in college. Who would have known that that would be lying in service to me 25 years later, but it did. So I think everything I learned here, even when I get frustrated at the lack of time that I had or the anxiety I had, it was good. I think this is a good place to be.
And for, like, I mean, personally, I want to go into film scoring. Would you advise, like, a young composer to start as early as possible or just wait until you mature enough before it?
I have taken on interns in the summer. Mm-hmm. I've been written, sometimes someone writes me on my website, you know, my website, seancallery.com, you know, I just say, I'm looking for an internship, and sometimes it works out. I learn a lot being around people who are doing it, because everyone does it differently. So I think there's no better way than to try to get into the orbit of a composer you admire, someone, and just reach out. I mean, you probably won't hear from a lot of people, but Daniel Licht, who writes for Dexter, who wrote for, he had a great piece of advice for me. He said, people who are interested in interning for me, I tell them to write me every 6 weeks, just to say hello. Because it's not stalking, you know, it's not every day, or like, here's my demo, you know, it's just like, it starts a dialogue going. And the people that I've ended up choosing are people I end up liking and trusting and so forth. So I would say, if it's within your ability, in the hiatuses and so forth, reach out in that regard and just practice. You know, practice scoring. There's so many things you can download now, and just practice, practice doing it.
Thank you.
Yeah, sure. Okay.
What is your favorite color? No, I'm kidding. Actually,
see, that email I would read. You see,
you talked a little bit earlier about how you get started. You're doing sound design for Deep Space Nine.
Yeah,
and I'm curious. You mentioned that in doing that, it actually you learned a lot about composing and becoming a composer for television. Can you elaborate on that? How that helped you?
In a real simple way, what it was that on Star Trek, you're working on telling a story, right? And sometimes the story, if there's a Cardassian battle scene with and people getting their butts blown away by phaser shots, the sound effects are going to tell the story. The visual effects are going to tell the story. There are times when Sisko is, you know, having an emotional moment with his son. The music's going to tell the story. There are just times when different trades are going to take turns actually representing the story. The story will be better told with those things in the pole position. So sometimes, you know, you're cutting these really elaborate sound effects and things, and they get muted, and you're like, what happened? Well, you know, the music is king here. You know, I always thought that the music was mixed really well in Star Trek. The effects were always, I don't say they take a back seat, but the music was always really well featured, and they always had like a 35-piece orchestra. So I learned a lot in the sense that sometimes you just recognized that as much as I wanted the music played louder on all the shows I've ever worked on, sometimes it's just not going to be, and it's for the right reason, even if emotionally as a composer it bums you out. You know, you can't hear it as much. I mean, it does happen. You don't hear, like, there's a show I work on, I won't say that, just I can't hear the music very much. Homeland I can hear really well. That's great. And anyway, I won't say any more than that. I don't want to say what show I'm disappointed in. I keep trying to get them to raise the level, but they won't. All right. Take a couple more. Are we good? I don't want to keep. Yeah, you're. Is all right.
Hi.
All good. Okay, good.
Thank you. I'm just wondering. So you were majoring in classical piano at NEC, but how do you prepare yourself to compose, or to, you know, how do you practice to be a film scoring composer?
When I got hired by the Synclavier people, now this is before you could have a laptop with sounds and stuff, I practiced at night on their computer systems there, just with orchestration, you know, just practice in that regard. That's available to most people now with certain software. programs. That was really how I just listened and studied, just watched films that and saw how they were spotted. The movie Jaws, if anybody, you know, that's an incredible score, incredibly spotted. We could go into a whole discussion about brilliant scores, but when I hear them, I study them. You know, you just want to hear what people did and how they you learn, and I think other composers are listening as well to other scores. But the practicing of it is simply that. I remember we had scenes from movies that we just practiced scoring to. You just practice, and you see how the kinds of choices people make that are really smart choices. That you think, well, that's a cool idea. That's a very cool idea. And it's nonstop learning, and I don't see that to be discouraging. It has to be. I'm starting this pilot that I don't know what the sound of it's going to be. You know, there's a little bit of agoraphobia, but you got to then settle down and see what the story is and see what comes up for you. You know. Sir.
Last.
You go. You have to go. Oh. No. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
You have. Do you ever find that you have difficulty generating the first idea in something? And if you do, do you have any like what are the tips and tricks you use to like come up with stuff to write?
If you're asking if I've ever had a block getting an idea going, yes. Yeah. No, it's look. There are times when nothing happens. You know, the day happens. You've done something. It sounds like shit. You come back the next morning. It still sounds like shit. You're just like what am I doing? You know, why am I in this career? I mean, I'm not trying to be too flippant about it, but there are just times when it's just not happening. There's only one thing I've ever done that's ever hit the reset button, and that's just, even with time constraints, you have to find a way to get up and walk away for a bit. I don't know what that is, whether it's taking a walk or just leaving the environment. Because if you're in a, it becomes a bit of a wormhole. It becomes you start shrinking, and then you just get so frustrated. But if you back away, a night's sleep, something to go to the gym, you know, something, anything to kind of shake it loose, and you come back, and almost immediately, if you can separate yourself from it for an hour or two, a point of view can emerge about how to proceed. And my wife is here, and sometimes she'll walk into the studio, and I'll just ask her, I said, how's this sound? And if she says really great, I'll know it's great. And if she says just great or good, then I know it's terrible. Anyway, that's a tough one. But just, yeah, say what?
Do what?
Would
you always go with your wife's
feelings? Generally, yeah, and that's not. I'm not saying that just because she's here, but no. But this Jessica Jones show, for example, I had to do some fight scenes with just a drum kit, which is like a trap set, and I thought, I think I'm gonna get really reamed for this. I think people are gonna feel this is weird, and I remember her saying, she goes, I think this is kind of cool, you know, and so you know, it feels good to hear. So you kind of keep going. Yes, you in the front. The question was, is it different for doing film as opposed to TV? The biggest difference between film and television, in my view, is that you're working on one single 2-hour thing that's broken up into 10 reels or so, and the picture's always changing and morphing and envelope. You're working on a single project, but you still have the same job of writing music to serve the story. You know, you still have that job, but you are definitely in a different delivery kind of environment. It's the times that I did it, the film kept reshaping. Then it went to a test screening, and then they said, "Oh, we didn't like this," and so they recut it. And then you kind of come back, and it's a longer process, but not by much. It's a longer process. TV is more in and out it goes, but the quality is rising in TV. So, video games and films, I think, are most alike. Because films have singular releases, video games have big releases, and video games are bigger than I think anything. I think they're the most profitable entertainment sector we have right now. Yes.
Is it easier to transfer the work that you've done when you
Yeah. Yeah. You know, in that case, I was happy to report that they just wanted the pure sound of 24 in the video game. So I didn't have to do a whole. I had to write new music for 24 for the game. In the TV show, a 24 mission would be 5 to 7 minutes. You know, blowing things up. But in a video game, it can take a guy 15 minutes or it can take him 7 minutes. You know, the mission, the story is completely ebbing and flowing based on it's adaptive. So you had to design the music in a way that could re-trigger the game engine back to different things. And I haven't done a game on the PS4 or anything like that, but now I understand there's huge multi-track layers now and stuff, so that it really feels like it's really like composed score just for you, you know, because of the layering and the things that can happen with it. And it's a lot of work. I mean, it's like 110 minutes of writing for a video game. Almost 2 hours of music. That's a lot. Hey,
how's it going?
Question.
Last question. How is the transition to Logic 10 for you? That's
This is just a tech answer. Yeah, no, it's okay. No, this is a good. It's a good question. I found that Logic 10 out of the gate felt a little slower to me than Logic 9, but Logic 9 was slower than Logic 8. I've gotten used to it. It was a little. I was one of the last ones to go. I knew I would eventually go, and then they did that major upgrade. It was there's a couple of major things I wish that would happen to it, and we could certainly talk about that privately. I'd love, you know, huh? You know what I wish? This is just another tech thing. You have all these sounds in your palette, but sometimes you just want to. I'd love to hit a screen set and go right to a certain sound at all times, and what happens is I always end up creating new sounds and new tracks, so your track count keeps rising and ebbing and flowing, but I'd always like it to anchor point to a certain sound no matter where it's sitting, because sometimes you just want to get to an instrument family and you can scroll down and get to it, or you can hide tracks to get to just the brass, but I don't like hiding tracks. I just want to be able to just anchor point to something, so when I hit it, because I do a lot of, I wonder how much time I'm taking searching for sounds and going up and down the track list. I've done 9 to 10. I haven't done anything more than that, and that's been mixed bag, but it was okay. It more or less it worked. Okay. Yes, now the last.
You were an intern. What did you go through to actually, you know, get the understanding of everything? I know that you followed your mentor around, but what did you actually do for the
It's a great question. The relationship was one of reciprocity. I had a skill set that he didn't have. I knew certain things about his equipment that he didn't know, so I was of value to him. Not as a composer at first, but as a person who could actually help address a particular situation for him. If you were particularly good at Pro Tools, or particularly good at sound design, or particularly good at some sort of thing, which I'm sure everyone is, everyone has something that's unique to them. That will be of value to somebody. Obviously, I don't mean to stress this, but you know, I've had some students, some kids come in, and they just want to start working right away, and they just expect it. And it's a bit odd, you know, because they have no training and there's a bit of a, like they're on a fast track and it just doesn't plug and play. They have to kind of log some time and experience watching what happens. But the guy on Bones, for example, Bones, the show I work on, the two people there were assistants of mine, and they're now credited on the show as composers. So, and they, that guy brought a level of organization to the library. You know, he had a mind for organizing the sound library, which I didn't have. So if you can bring the reciprocity is what I think is great. Anyway, well, listen, this is a Friday, so I know you could be doing anything but this, so thank you for being here, and I really appreciate it. Your time. Thank you.